Hello, this is Joseph from Gorilla3D. In this screencast, we'll be going over the basics of JavaScript and why a framework is so important to use before you even know how to learn to program. To start, JavaScript is a very easy language to learn. It's built into almost every browser. This means you don't need to download anything to start programming. In fact, if you're watching this video, you're probably using a browser. Before we start, I'd like to state a problem with JavaScript. JavaScript is implemented with the DOM. The DOM, D-O-M, means Document Object Model. It's what the browser uses to let developers have access to the graphical interface. When you see an image rotate or text fade in or out, that's probably JavaScript interacting with the DOM. So what's wrong with the DOM? Well, each browser seems to have a broken implementation of it. This is where frameworks help out, because when you write script for one browser, it may not work in another. So using the built-in libraries that a framework provides will help you unify your ability to write for multiple browsers. The second problem with JavaScript is that browser. The browser makes it very hard to share with because the browser is very secure. You can't just share it without a host. Anything done via open file will disable very important parts of the browser's features. These features is what makes JavaScript so great in the first place. On top of that, hosts cost money. You just can't skimp on paying that. If you do, you probably end up configuring your own host. And if you get that far by that point, it's probably not useful to even learn JavaScript. This is where Jsfiddle.net comes in. Jsfiddle is a development platform to learn, share, and develop your JavaScript work. As the screencast continues, you can use Jsfiddle to switch between the JavaScript frameworks, such as Mootools, or jQuery, or Prototype. These JavaScript frameworks will help you extend your knowledge beyond the actual language of JavaScript itself and into the browser. You can also use other options such as debugging with JSLint to help you figure out what part of your code is wrong. So, let's jump into one of the hardest aspects of JavaScript, which is actually not JavaScript at all. Ajax requests. Ajax requests send information in the background and receive them as well. It's great to use on forms or loading large sets of information in chunks. Examples are paginations, you know, the pages with numbers at the bottom or even at the top. You click them and you go to the next page, then you reload the entire page, the header, the footer. You can actually use JavaScript and Ajax together to only load the content in the middle. Another example is endless scrolling, when you start to scroll and more content's populated at the very bottom. The biggest benefit of using Ajax is really less data. You don't have to send the header, you don't have to send the footer, you don't have to send endless HTML. Rather, you can use condensed data like JSON, the JavaScript object notation. JSON is the serialized form of JavaScript objects. These objects can be used and evaluated on the client side to iterate and use to write HTML. It's a lot to take in, but it's one of the biggest concepts of JavaScript and why it's so popular right now. Less data means less waiting time. You're able to separate your computational intense logic into separate requests. I mentioned earlier JSON. Keep this in mind. Catch errors. Most errors are catched on the server side. We'll kind of skip of what the server side and client side is and just kind of understand that the server side is not what you're actually programming. By catching errors on the client side, you're able to prevent the entire page from failing. This will usually result in a 500 response or 404 of some sort. You have no control over the page at that point. It's the server serving the content to the end user. So with Ajax request, you can actually request in the background and catch when it fails. Even better is that you can react to the user by telling them it failed and that you're trying again. If you use Gmail, which is a browser-based email, then I'm sure you have gotten disconnected or still waiting before. So rather than loading the page and doing nothing for several seconds, you can use that time to instead inform the user about what's going on. So, before we begin to actually learn about JavaScript, let's look at some code. I'm not expecting you to know what this does, so I'll be kind and explain it. They both do the same exact thing. They're just different ways using different frameworks. And it's kind of the point of what this slide actually represents. Choosing a framework to really start with. And if you can't tell, one of them actually looks a bit readable and the other kind of isn't. And this really is dependent on what you consider as readable. I'll take preference on the right side, and I'm sure someone else will take preference on the left-hand side. So now I reveal which framework belongs to which part of JavaScript. Now what you pick for each language really is not dependent on what you want to do with it, because really all the frameworks do exactly the same thing, just about. So when I showed you the two examples of doing the same exact code, or the same exact execution but different amount of code, it's really depending on what you see fit. So on the left hand side, jQuery is very great for designers. They don't have to really understand what's going beyond what they're pasting, so they can simply get quick functionality in there, leave it alone, and never have to look at it again. However, if you're going to be managing a project for a very long time over a large amount of code, you might want to consider Mootools. Mootools actually extends the language itself, so it's going to be a bit harder to use other libraries with it, but it's still not an impossible task. You can actually use both jQuery and Mootools to kind of use within itself. So what you might consider as better code for Mootools, you might consider better functionality in jQuery. So you might use jQuery to do the functionality, but the actual descriptions can be done in Mootools. In either sense, whatever framework you pick, it's going to be great. So in the previous slide, I had mentioned the two frameworks, and that one was actually a bit nicer to work with than the other. Well, I'll actually want to talk about one of the bigger things that JavaScript really presents to the end developer, and that is the ability to extend its own language. You can add new classes, new functions on top of objects, even after they're initiated. So anything that is an array, you can automatically add a function to the end of it, and it'll apply to all your arrays. This is what Mootools really strives for, is to extend the language far enough so you become productive in it. jQuery, on the other hand, doesn't like that notation. It likes to keep its own abilities within its own namespace. This is so you can use other frameworks in your own code and still maintain a good amount of functionality and speed. The next part of this slide is very important. We've already gone over the ability to extend the language or stay within your own namespace. So the next part is really what defines why someone would want to write in jQuery and why someone would want to write in something like Mootools. jQuery not only stays within itself, but it uses a lot of shortcuts. These shortcuts are usually dependent on what you want to do. So in the left-hand example, the reference of this, of the success function, is based on the context you provide in the object of the Ajax request. So context is document body, and you call this, add a class, and it adds the class of done to the body. The problem with this is that you have to know that the context exists in the first place. So this comes to where Mootools steps in. Mootools provides the same functionality, but a very different methodology. So we bind the body to the function of complete to use this. Now if you don't understand what this is, it's really just referencing itself. So you can bind different types of things to it. So when you read context body, you don't really understand what it's doing. However, when you read function bind, and you see that it's bind to the function that's using this, then you're more able to recognize what the code is doing. And this is the biggest problem with frameworks, like jQuery and like Mootools, is that there's a huge fight on what's readable and what's not, and really what it comes down to is what you're actually doing. And that's what designers are kind of really picking up with jQuery and why it's so popular, is that you can do it without having to really understand it, and it just works. It works great, and it works in other browsers, just like any other framework. So why bother learning another?